for the first time.
What kind of a break was that, Helwani? My goodness, what do you do? 20 minutes there?
Well, there's a lot to reconfigure here. As you can see, it looks completely different. We're now sitting side by side. It's a different configuration. Yeah. What do you think?
Go ahead. I'll quit interrupting.
No.
Pretend like it's your show.
I mean, I can't believe how things timed out there. That was kind of the first time that you ever sort of threw a grenade in the direction of one Wanderlei Silva. Now here you are about to fight him at MSG of all places.
Look at that. Are you coming?
I will be there.
MSG stands for Madison Square Garden.
That's right.
You've heard of it?
Yes.
It's
the world's most famous arena, home of the New York Knickerbockers.
That's what they say. How can you possibly prove it's the most famous arena? What do you take a poll of somebody? You've gone to Tokyo and asked them if they... Come on.
So here you are.
Westland High School. That's right. More people know about Westland High School.
So you are unimpressed with the fact that you're fighting MSG. It could have been anywhere.
Honestly, yes, but you don't want to sound like that. I mean, that's anticlimactic. You don't want to sound like a dick about it, but it's like, well, what do I care where they put the fight at? I mean, at some point they're going to set up a cage and we're going to walk out there and we're going to fight. So I certainly don't want to downplay and take away from my own esteem of getting to headline the Garden. But as to where the fight happens, they could do it wherever they want.
Only two other people in the history of this great sport have headlined MSG, and it just happened.
Is that right?
Well, yeah.
Because we just got in here. So yeah, Conor
and Eddie Alvarez.
Conor and Eddie.
Yeah.
Oh, that's the two people. One, two. All right.
Usually they take two to tango, you know.
That's right. And I apologize. They just boxed there a week ago. Triple G. Triple
Against,
G boxed
Daniel
there.
Jacobs.
I guess it was awesome.
It was a good event, yeah.
Pay-per-view flop, 170. But did you go to it?
I didn't go. No.
I heard it was great. I just met a gal with a Sports Illustrated named Maggie. She was there.
Maggie
said it was
Gray.
A scene, man. Yeah, she's great. She's smart.
Yeah.
She knew the sport.
Right.
You deal with people, and so do I, that are reporters, and they cover it, and 5 minutes in, you go, oh, you've never seen this. Oh, you don't know my name's Chael. Yeah. Oh, that's embarrassing.
They'll call you Kale or something.
All the time, and you just roll with it, and it sucks. But she knew what was up. She knew what time it was.
Are you feeling a buzz for this? I mean, look, we could talk about whether it's the world's most famous or not. This kind of came out of left field. I don't think anyone thought, A, Bellator was getting back in the pay-per-view business just yet, and B, they were going to MSG. It's expensive to run MSG.
Oh, you know that
as a promoter, right? I mean, this thing costs a lot of money. Were you surprised when they told you this was our plan for the fight?
Yes, on both. In fact, so here's what I got. You always wonder how Bellator keeps a secret. I tried to share this with you privately, but I think you thought I was working you.
Sure.
The way Bellator keeps a secret, by example, Mitrione versus Fedor. Nobody knew till they walked the ramp. Now, I can tell you nobody knew they were going to fight because I was on the broadcast team live on television, and I did not know until Mitrione and then Fedor walked the ramp what was going to happen. I fought Tito. The night I fought Tito, King Mo and Rampage walked out and did a spot to build up their fight. I've been hanging out with King Mo all week. I said, why didn't you tell me you're fighting Rampage? That's a big deal for me.
Yeah.
He said, man, I didn't know. And this was the same thing that happened with Fedor. They had him sign a blank contract. It's how they keep a secret. So they did that with me. It said New York. It said 205 pounds, and that was it. And it said June 24th. Didn't tell me who the opponent was. I didn't know it was the Garden. And I signed it. I came out of practice, and Luke Thomas had sent me a text. Apparently, Bellator broke the news. And he said, hey, can you come on and talk about your fight with Wanderlei? And I said, am I fighting Wanderlei? So that's how it stayed a secret.
Wow.
And then I didn't know it was the Garden. I thought that was a big deal. I thought it was a big deal that they came in, booked the Garden.
Yeah.
Pay-per-view, always a big deal. And it's been a good energy, man. People are pumped about it. But Bellator's been doing that. I'm brand new at Bellator. Came in November. First show I did was a commentator. I did it at the Mohegan Sun. Second show I did was San Jose. So opposite sides of the country. Sold out the Mohegan Sun for Phil Davis main event. Sold out in San Jose on the West Coast to watch Chandler fight. So yeah, man, they're gaining steam.
Okay, so we have a lot to talk about, and I've been waiting to talk to you. I was waiting for the right opportunity, and I'm glad that we're doing it in person. Before I get into everything, I don't want to forget, because we're going to get on a roll here. Dylan Danis mentioned that you had some breaking news regarding him. So can you tell us, just so we're still on that thread, what is the breaking news?
Submission Underground 4 is going to be May 14th, live at Flow. Flow Combat, to be exact.
That Dylan site's still Danis. Around? I'm kidding. I'm joking.
Yeah, that site's kicking ass, man. Dylan Danis is going to be taking on none other than Jake Shields in the main event.
Wow.
Co-main event will be Paulo Meow. He is going to be taking on the California kid, Uriah Faber.
Whoa.
Plenty more matches on that card. Nathan Orchard, Perez. We got more matches to announce, but the main and co-main, yes, Dylan versus Jake. I'd like to say this about Dylan, because he does rub some people the wrong way. I will just tell you, behind the scenes, that dude is the real deal. He will come on and talk tough, behind the scenes, he will sign the contract and do the heavy lifting. And I cannot say that about everybody from grappling. I've been so disappointed with grapplers. The biggest bunch of wusses I've ever met. I thought fighters were a bunch of wusses. The grappling community is the biggest, fakest bunch of tough guys I've ever met. And you cannot get any one of those cowards to do anything that involves putting their reputation on the line. Dylan Danis will do it against anybody at any weight.
Did you try to do him versus John Jones?
No, we never tried that. Now, he wanted that. Yeah, yeah. He wanted that match. Gordon Ryan, Gary Tona both wanted that match. And John was all for it. John didn't have a problem, but no, we were never behind it. We did try to do Mitrione and John Jones, and that may still happen down the road, but you saw what happened with Mitrione. Sure. And no, we did not try to do it. But he did. He was on board.
So the last time we spoke was the week of your fight against Tito Ortiz. So you had yet to really go through a full Bellator fight week as a fighter. Being in the UFC for so long, in hindsight, what was it like? Were you impressed? Are there still some things they have to work out? Is it a well-oiled machine? I mean, just that experience of going through the entire fight week, what was that like for you? Changing scenery after all those years with the UFC.
So you actually asked me a question that I didn't think you, I thought you were going to ask me about my own preparation. However, as far, yes, it's a very well-oiled machine.
Okay.
Like as far as being in the back, you know, right where your cues are, you've got your room, your locker room. Commissions largely run that. They just kind of tell you, Bellator just kind of tells you when to walk. It's great. So many people ask me the differences between Bellator and the UFC, and it's a really hard question because, Errol, there's so many similarities. You know, don't forget, Scott Coker. Scott Coker, when they bought Strikeforce and Dana brought it, and Dana's the mastermind of this whole sport, right? Nobody knows more than Dana. Dana saw a problem right out of the gate, and he did his best to put Coker on the shelf because he knew, look, there's no reason to smarten this guy up. This guy's already a smart guy. He's only got X amount a month non-compete. Yep. We're going to be seeing him again. That's a tremendous compliment. Dana knew there's no reason to make this guy any wiser than he already is. So, I mean, he really knows the game. He has a lot of similar employees. He's got his own team around him, but they have traded a little bit. And I just saw more similarities than I did differences.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay, so you enjoyed it. You had no issues.
Yeah, that's right.
Did it feel like it was your first day at school? So, you know, like the new people, new faces?
A little bit.
Were you a little more nervous?
Yeah, that's right. Yeah, a little bit. And I don't do first day at school any better than anybody else. I can remember going into ESPN for my first day, and I didn't have any friends and who to talk to. And I still experience that even as an adult. And so, yeah, there was a little bit of that at Bellator, but it is smaller. So it's easier to meet people quickly. Make name and recognition and shake hands. So, yeah, man, I feel like I've always been at Bellator now. I mean, it's only been 4 or 5 months, but I don't remember any different.
I remember saying on the Monday after that fight, perhaps in hindsight, we put a little too much pressure on you. We forgot that you had not fought in 4 years. We forgot that you were fighting for a new promotion. We forgot that, you know, you had been through a lot, you know, both personally and professionally. Fox, ESPN, things with your family. There was a lot of stuff on your shoulders, in your mind, going into that fight. This is sort of trying to make sense of what happened in there against Tito Ortiz. Is it fair? I mean, I'm not trying to give you an out or make you say any excuses, but did we expect a little too much after such a long layoff?
I don't think so.
Okay.
Ring rust was a real thing.
Yeah.
And I didn't know anything about that. I denied it. I've heard other fighters deny it. And then when they come through it, they go, oh, my goodness.
Can you do me a favor? Can you put your phone? Because it's like right on your thing. And I'm like thinking of
right on my crotch there. I'm sorry. Here, let me
turn very nervous.
Really? I appreciate you thinking of me.
I'm worried about you.
We don't want my testicles to get cancer, do we?
Can you put
thank
yes,
you, Hawani. appreciate that. So let's see here. So, yeah, the ring list was a real thing. I didn't know anything about it. I denied it. But it is a different speed. Tito sucks. I mean, Tito's so bad. And when you lose to a guy, then you suck. That's the way it works, man. I wouldn't put that guy down without putting myself down. Tito is the worst fighter I've ever fought, but now that makes me the worst fighter. And I just didn't know that about myself. You know, I had good rounds in practice, and you get a little bit older, and I haven't done it. And the second that fight ended, I was like, oh my goodness, just please, I need another chance. Now I know all the things that I forgot and all the things that I took for granted. I tried to fight Fedor a couple of weeks after that, and it didn't have anything to do with Fedor. I mean, I was trying to help the company save the show and those type things, but I wanted in there so bad. It's like, wait a minute. It all came back to me. I was walking in the back after Tito, and I'm going, you know, that guy, he was so bad. And it just came back. I don't really know how else to say it than that. I don't know if that's a great example, but that was my experience. And I don't think there was too much on me. It was a good spot. And don't forget, it was 3 rounds. That's a fair thing to ask of a guy. Got to headline the show, which added to my motivation. So I don't think anybody put too much on me. It's just the reality is that that's where I was at.
Do you still feel like he sucks, Tito?
Oh, Tito's terrible. And yeah, Tito was absolutely terrible. I was in the fight with him.
Yeah.
And that fight ended, and some people said it was a fixed fight,
yes,
to use that term.
I wanted to ask you about that.
And it's like, guy, I don't know how else to, when you fight so poorly that some people can't imagine you fought that poorly. They think it has to be fit. That's not good. On some hands, it's funny. We can sit here and laugh about it, but that's how bad it was. And there was one situation with Tito where he yelled tap and I let go. And if you watch the video, it like shows his hand. I didn't think his hand was tapping, but like some kids could break it.
Yeah, yeah.
His hand did this, but I just have to say, in fairness, this doesn't always mean tap. Sometimes this could mean other things. You've seen Diaz slap a guy. Yeah. You know, every time your hand does this, it doesn't mean tap. However, that also does mean tap. So that was taken a little bit out of proportion, and I thought that it took away from Tito's win. I didn't think that was right. I thought that, hey, listen, he won. That's just the way it goes. And you got to give a guy. If a guy has, because I've had that go both ways too. I've been in fights or wrestling matches where the other guy was better. I knew he was better, but I won. Mm. But it's my night. You got to give me my night. Goes both ways.
Was that weird though for you? And maybe weird is putting it kindly. Like when you have actual colleagues, other fighters, Dan Hardy, saying that this looked like a choreographed fight, and fans just throwing, oh, this was fake, this was fake. I mean, that's kind of an insult, right?
Oh, I have to think so. But again, you got to understand, if you're being very candid about it, if your performance is so bad that there is no other explanation and somebody just goes, that's what happened. You want to hear something on the other side of it? I have been in intellectual conversations with smart people, people like you, about John Jones, right, where you're trying to explain how we're so good. And I can't make sense of it. It's not because he's experienced. It's not because he's worked so hard or paid some price. And I have had people tell me he was just chosen by God. God has just decided to make, and I've accepted. I've been like, yeah, that's what it is. And I go, well, no, wait a second. God doesn't care who's winning a fight. But I have no other explanation for why he's so great. So I'm using the other end of the spectrum. But I have defaulted to divine intervention.
Huh. And that's what,
because sometimes you can't explain it. Sometimes you go, look, I'm watching the same video as you are. I see what you're seeing. That's not what happened, but I get it.
Was that the lowest moment of your career as far as athletically? I mean, you've lost to some of the greatest ever, but considering how low you think of his skills.
Yeah, so I'm a performance guy. I'm not an outcome guy. Like when I sit and I think about it or have my proud moments, it's where did I perform well? And then if the outcome took care of itself, great, good for me. Or from a wrestling perspective, if I had more points than the other guy, then good for me. But some of my best wrestling matches, I lost them. But boy, I was proud of those. I had really good performance. Then you try to trace it backwards and go, okay, what happened? What did I have for breakfast that day? How much did I sleep the night before? Was there some song I listened to? Why did I have such a good performance? And if you ever lose a match, but you went out and you really performed well, you can sleep easy at night. When you don't bring your skills, it's very tough. And so intrinsically, that's just what I dealt with, where I went, oh my goodness, you know, I worked so hard for this. I was prepared. I had great coaches and great partners. But you got to go out there and perform, and it's so important to do. And I think of myself as a performance guy sometimes where I haven't felt good, but I've stepped up, and I'm proud of that. And when you go out and you step down, yeah, man, you do some soul searching because you don't want it to happen again. It's very embarrassing, and it's a letdown, not just to you or to your fans, but to your coaches. You know, my coaches put in a lot of time with me for very little thanks. And I do feel that I owe it to them. I owe them a performance, and we don't give it to them. There's nothing you can do, Errol. You just walk away, and you try again.
With that line of thinking in mind, would the first Anderson Silva fight be one of your favorite fights because the performance was great, you fell just short? It was one of your finest. I mean,
I appreciate you saying that.
Is that not?
That might be a good example. Here's the reason I can't answer your question. I never watched that fight. I remember coming out of the ring that night, and the first person that intercepted me was Joe Silva. And I just thought it was such a boring fight. And I said to Joe, I'm sorry. And I'm never the guy that goes, oh, sorry. So you pat him on the back and go, no, you did a really good job. I thought it was just a slow-paced, boring fight. I did not know until the reception that people gave. They gave me fight of that night that night. They brought it into the locker room. That's how they used to do it. And this guy comes up and he says, Lorenzo and Dana want you to have this fight of the night. I thought, that's a consolation prize. That was a terrible fight. And then other people told me how great, including later. So thank you for bringing it up. But I just didn't know in the moment. You don't really know. I didn't know how bad the Tito fight. I didn't know any of that until it was after the fact. And I didn't go back and and watch that match. I have a hard time rewatching matches, but
you've never watched the Anderson fight once.
I never watched it.
On like a slow day. Let me just see this.
No, and
it was 99% in your favor.
Yeah, thanks. And when I got ready to fight him the second time, the UFC, as part of their marketing, made me sit down and watch that fight and then give an analysis, and I couldn't do it. I tried so hard, and I think it's a weakness. I don't think it's a good thing. I think you can get better by watching your tape. Yeah. Win or lose, I think it's a good thing to sit down, use that technology, get with a coach, take some notes, and get better. I think it's a weakness of mine, but either way, I can't rewatch. Man, I get nervous. My hands get sweaty.
Wait, that particular fight or all your losses?
Any match. I've never seen a win or a loss. I don't rewatch them. Yeah,
really?
including with wrestling. Yeah, which you would think with today's technology, I mean, game film is a really strong thing, but I can't do it.
Even your finest hour.
Yeah, my finest hour.
Beating Nate Marquardt or Dan Miller, one of these guys.
Yeah. Yeah, that's right. I can't go back and rewatch him. I'll even get asked about him. What happened to this fight? And say, I'll always give an answer, but in my heart, I don't know, man. I can't remember him.
What was going through your mind when he's like celebrating, his son's there, and he's going all crazy?
Anderson?
No, Tito Ortiz.
Oh.
Considering how you feel about him as a human being, was that tough to just be in the cage for all of that?
Yeah, you got to understand, he yelled tap, and that's hard.
You're saying he verbally tapped.
Yeah, and my coach has even said, well, why you don't stop until the referee steps in. It's like, man, I understand that. I'm not going to give a guy any more mercy than somebody else. But there is still some rules. You know, when a guy says stop, it's one of the only codes we go by. So I don't know that I wouldn't do that again. It's like, if a guy says stop, you stop. And you got to understand, Tito has a bad neck. In real life, Tito has a bad neck. I want to beat Tito that night. I do not like Tito. I don't want him to have a bad life. I don't want him to go on with a bad neck. I just don't. So, I don't know that I would do that any different. When he did that with his kid, I got the whole thing. I would have done the same thing. And you take it, and it goes on. When we got into the back, and he was still a jerk about it, that confused me. It's like, Tito, you're terrible. I'm the name that's going to move this company forward. You got to pass the torch. You know, if you're choosing to step aside, either way, I move forward, and so does the brand. And so there's an etiquette you have to do there. To be a dick in the back, after you suck and you beat me. I mean, come on, this is a bad feeling for me. I beat you when we were kids in 40 seconds. I never brought it up, let alone rubbed it in after the fact. I thought that was very bizarre. He then demanded I apologize to him at the press conference. And it's like, Tito, you yell tap, I let go. I physically tapped and you didn't let go. You know, if that would have been my knee, you remember Paul Harris situations or an arm or something like that, you really could have injured me. And I let go to not injure you. I was tapping and you didn't let go. The commission would sanction him. They would fine him if he wasn't retiring. I told the commission, we're good, man. Things were said. There's some heat here. We're good. And fortunately, because it was a choke and everything ends well, but it's like, Tito, we don't have very many rules. But we have to follow that one. When a guy says, I've had enough, man, he's had enough.
Are you surprised that Big John, if you heard him say tap, that he didn't stop it? I mean, of all people.
No. Well, so here's the thing. In fairness to the story, because I'm saying he said tap, but in fairness, Tito says I did not say tap. Tito said, I said, I'm fine. But he could be telling the truth. You know, if you want to be real honest about it, Tito could be telling the truth. He might have said, I'm fine. I thought he said tap.
Okay.
I thought he said tap twice. I thought he said tap, tap. He's saying he said, I'm fine. It's the same amount of syllables. It's my opinion versus his, and I'm not calling him a liar on it. I'm just telling you what I thought happened, so I let the position go. And a lot of people saw it on TV, and it was the same time that he was doing this motion. So they thought he was signaling to me. This is all conspiracy theory, but you and I like conspiracies,
sure,
right?
Well,
so let's visit on it. They thought this was a signal to me to let the move go. And it's like, man, you're close. I let the move go because he tapped.
And last thing on the fight in particular, that choke that you tapped to, is that something that you tap to usually?
So rear naked choke. So I can't totally remember the position, but I remember, not being able to breathe.
Okay. It looked like your face was turning red.
Yeah, it was. I did not think he had the position.
Yeah.
And I remember not respecting, there's some things you can do, some basic hand fighting, some place you can put your elbow, try to turn on top. And I remember not respecting the position and just thinking he doesn't have it. And I was right. Like, he didn't have it until he did. And I remember that moment going, oh my goodness, I'm going to have to tap. I was like, please, I'm going out.
Considering how big of a signing you were for Bellator, and we talked about this on the Monday before, you know, ratings and things like that, you want to give them back something, right?
Sure.
I mean, you want to prove to them that it was worth their while to sign you. When you got home that Monday, Wes Lynn, were you feeling like, man, I let them down? Did that thought cross your mind?
Yeah. Yeah, it did for me.
How did you cope with that?
Well, so here's the only thing I know to do. And I've had my ups and downs. And as you've been friends a long time, and one thing we both do, we move forward. Mm-hmm. And it's the only thing you can do. You have a really good day. You have to move forward. I've seen guys, and I've been guilty of it, of being high on life and everything's going great, and you miss a step. You don't show up one day. You relax a little bit. You rest on your laurels. You get comfortable. And then that dip comes. You know, it's a law of life. Whatever goes up must come down. And some people don't know how to deal with that. But the downs are the same thing. You get up the next day, you put your boots on, and you move forward. And but I do hear your point that I had plans and visions in a way I was going to do it. And when that stuff gets, you know, when you have a bad moment, you got to say, hey, let me go. You got to start over sometimes.
Yeah.
And it was hard, particularly for me, just because of how I look at Tito. I look at him like he sucks. So when you lose to a guy who sucks, you got to face it, then I suck. Things have to change. Things have got to change. You know, you beat a guy that's a champion of the world, you got to say, I'm the best fighter in the world. But it you get the booby prize the same way. And numbers, it was great. We did record numbers. We beat other promotions and everybody. We sold out a huge arena. So as far as them getting their bang for their buck for Chael P, yes, I came through. But on what I wanted to deliver, and I'm a company guy. You know, if you're going to give me $5 million, but I can make you 10, I want to make you 20. And I'm not going to ask for a penny more. I want Coker and these guys that are taking these risks and the investment. I want them to clean up. But that's just a different mentality. I'm a company guy.
So you say something has to change. What is going to change?
Yes. Well, I mean, I went crazy. As soon as I lost that fight, I went crazy, training-wise.
Okay.
And, to go back to the night I tried to fight Fedor,
yeah.
I was just ready. I was ready mentally. I was ready physically. I went absolutely crazy. I lost to Tito on a Saturday. It was a Saturday night card. I was training hard on Monday, two-a-days on Monday.
Wow.
And, you know, that's actually something I learned as an example from Randy Couture. Randy Couture, good day or bad day, would be in the practice room on Monday. And I've always followed that. But much like Randy, maybe my intensity would be down. I'd be there, but maybe I wasn't working as hard as the other guys. I was in two-a-days every day and just buckled down, you know, because you don't want those things to happen again. And there's no way to fix it. Errol, I can sit here and tell you I'm training so hard and blah, blah, blah. That doesn't mean you're going to win the next one, but you put yourself in the position to.
Yeah.
You do everything you can to create an environment so that you can be successful. And then you look at the scoreboards, and one guy's got more points than the other guy.
Was part of the reason why you wanted to take that Fedor fight on hours' notice because you wanted to sort of pay them back? You know, you wanted to make good on what happened January 21st in Inglewood, California.
Yeah.
Like, did you feel, okay, I need to do something to save this show?
That's right. I think that's fair. So, a little bit of it was to pay him back. I mean, listen, at the end of the day, it penciled. Okay,
everybody
did great. But, I'm part of the company. The company needs a main event. I'm here. I'm licensed. I'm healthy. Yeah, so I just thought it made sense. I didn't understand why other people didn't want that fight or what it. I've never understood that, though, man. I know some guys that say they want to be fighters, but when it's like those grappling wussies I'm telling you about, man, they all want to be tough guys with their gis on and get on the magazines until somebody offers them a match, and then they're the last guy that wants to go out there and compete. That's okay, but that's not me, man.
How close did it get? The Fedor fight.
I went to bed thinking I was fighting Fedor. Now,
the night before.
Yeah, I didn't go to bed until about 12:15. I got out of a meeting with Bellator, and I left that meeting thinking I was going to fight. Now, they did not tell me I had the fight. It's just things were lining up, and I was the only guy there if Mitrione couldn't go. So a lot of that I had created on my own, but it was still my thought. I woke up the next day, and they said, look, this is Mitrione's fight until he pulls out, and he has not pulled out. He was right on the verge, mm-hmm. and Matt was telling me, I'm going to get this 95% right, but so he had the kidney stone, but it had moved, and he could either pass it and he could fight, or it could fall back into his kidney. It'd be terribly painful, but he could fight. The state he was in, he was paralyzed, essentially.
Yeah.
He could not move. He couldn't get up. And then it was the next morning at like 2 or 3 a.m. it passed and all would have been well, but he missed the bell.
So coincidentally, he's fighting Fedor, co-main event of this card against Wanderlei Silva. You're headlining at MSG on June 24th. Is there any, I don't know, for lack of a better word, fear, doubt in your mind that for whatever reason this fight doesn't come to fruition, that Wanderlei, I mean, we've been teased about this fight before, right?
With Wanderlei, I can't imagine it. I can't imagine it not happening. You know, I do not like Wanderlei. I'm not a Wanderlei defender. But if I was to be fair about his career, Errol, I can't remember a fight he's ever pulled out of. I can't remember him doing that. If he has, I just can't.
Recently
remember.
With Mirko Krokop.
With Krokop. Was that fight signed? Because I read they were going to fight on like New Year's. And that was a little bit weird. But to your point, just recently, he did have something with Krokop. I don't know if that was ever signed, but I don't remember him bailing out. I just don't remember it could happen. I don't like the guy, but I also don't acknowledge that he's a chicken. I think he's a guy that goes out there and fights. And I'll definitely be there.
This dates back many years. I mean, we showed that clip from 2011. Why don't you like him? What is it about Wanderlei that you do not like?
We just could never get it right. And you know, I can't really remember where it started. I remember the first time I ever saw Wanderlei Silva.
When was that?
He walked into Randy Couture's gym. I was in there sparring.
How long ago?
No mouthpiece. So I was getting ready to fight Paulo Filho.
Oh, wow. WBC.
Yeah. And I don't remember when that was, but...
First or second?
2009.
Okay.
First or the second.
But we're trying to paint a picture here.
Yeah, a number of months apart.
Right. Doesn't matter.
I think it was 2009. He came in, I was sparring, I had no mouthpiece. And anytime you're sparring, you don't have a mouthpiece, not a good idea.
Right.
When you're at a new gym where you don't know the guys and you have no mouthpiece, you just shouldn't spar. But I was there, I had traveled, I had to do the workout. And I told Wanderlei, he came in, and that was Wanderlei Silva, you know, there's an aura about him, if you will. And I didn't know how his English was or mine. So I just smiled real big and pointed to my mouth. And he said, okay. And so we sparred the round. Huh. He never threw a punch at me. He took care of me the entire time, let me throw my combinations on him. And then he even coached me a little bit. He said that I should be, after I punched, to finish combinations with kicks. He was just a great guy. And you know, he spars really hard. He's the last guy you want to go with without a mouthpiece. And I thought, well, what a great guy. I had a good experience with him. A little bit later, he opened his gym. I happened to be in town, so I went down for the grand opening. Everything was fine. I had my Anderson fight, and I was doing some kind of a press tour with Wanderlei. And we ended up in a van together, and we spent the whole day together. And he had his own videographer with him. And at some point, he cues the guy up. And he cuts like a promo on me, you know, tell me to watch my mouth and you do these things in Brazil and you lose your teeth. And he was doing this whole thing. And I just thought, Wanderlei, this is really weird because first off, you're telling me off, which is a little bit, that's rude. Second, we spent the whole day together. Like we're in a van, man. What are you trying to start a fight with me in a van after we spent the day? And third, you brought the cameraman. Like this is just, it's just weird. And, you know, so yeah, I got my ego too, you know, and I kind of admired the guy, but I got my ego too. So I had to push back and then, you know, he went crazy or whatever happened. And it's like, hey, well then game on, man. You know, I appreciate you looking after me that one day, but if this is the way you want to go, I'm a fighter too.
And so it all started there in that van. I think that was in Austin, Texas.
Yeah, that's right. It was in Austin,
Texas.
Jen Wink was in the car. And I just thought it was really inappropriate. It's like, Wanderlei, I get if you're trying to make a name.
Yeah.
You know, and I was on top, but hey, you've been on top too. You don't need to get a name off of me. Man, you're still Wanderlei Silva. You headline some big cards, and you're going to keep headlining some cards. And I just thought it was a really weird thing to do, particularly that he brought the video guy.
Yeah.
And then things just went bad to worse. You know, you're going back a number of years, but I remember we were on the set of The Ultimate Fighter in Brazil.
Yeah.
And I was persona non grata in Brazil at that time. You're wiping your nose. Is that me?
No. That's just me.
Oh, your nose itches. Okay.
I have a big nose. It gets all right.
So that's your comment, not mine. So anyway, we ended up out there, and he starts a street fight with me. And it's like, Wanderlei, I'm by myself. I have nobody, and I'm the bad guy here. So if you come out and you pick on me, you're going to humanize me, and you're going to humble me to the audience, which is going to make them like me, which is not what I'm here for. The script is written, man. I'm the bad guy. You be the white knight. You come save your country, and we'll go fight this out on pay-per-view. This is really obvious, but if you bully me while I'm alone, it's going to have the reverse effect. So first, now you just lost my respect because now you're a dummy.
Yeah.
You don't get it, which makes, if you don't understand the business, I can't respect you in this business. And then secondly, my wife was there. You start a fist fight with me, which I end up getting jumped. One of his cronies jumps me in front of my wife. It's like, Wanderlei, I don't like you at all, but if you show up somewhere with your wife, we're doing it your way. You tell Chael to go stand in the corner with his pants down, and your wife's, I'm going to do it. I'm going to make you look good in front of your wife. I'm not going to start a fight. This is like bro code 101, and we don't have a bunch of honor, man. It's two thieves in this thing together. but my wife's there and you're going to start a fight with me, man, that was hard.
Wow, I could see, like, you actually, that really pissed you off.
It disappointed me more than anything because, Errol, it goes back to what I told you at the beginning. When I very first saw the guy, he had like an aura around him, man. It was like the first time I saw Royce Gracie in person. It was a big deal. I remember that moment. I'm a fan first. You know, now I'm a fighter and a commentator. I've got my place in this sport, but I started as a fan, and that's how my career will end. I'm a fan. I admire these guys. So you got a guy like Wanderlei that's done everything that I'm trying to do. At this point in my career, when I meet him, I'm trying to get to where he is. And he's going to go and pull something like that. It's like, Wanderlei, come on, man. I've been around him where his kids are there. The gig is up, man. Your kids are there. You win.
When's the last time you spoke to him? Was it at that press conference when you guys did the face-to-face with Dana?
Yeah, 2014.
You won't believe this. He's on the phone. He called in.
This second?
Right now.
Oh, what? I wouldn't believe that Ariel set that up. No,
You think I have a way of calling Wanderlei Silva in the middle? Listening to the show,
I do.
Heard the stories. You think I have that power?
I think you do.
I don't.
I see a glimmer in your eye. I'll stick to kayfabe.
Wanderlei, are you there? Wanderlei Silva, are you on the phone?
Yeah, my friend. I hear everything. And I know.
That's him.
You talking like, man, you need to talk to Chael. He's talking like a loser, man. Man, I'm not your friend, man. You know that. You know we have some problems. If you come to see a lot of this sad history, fuck yourself, man. Let's do that. Man, why do you talk all that history? I'm fine. Fuck yourself, man. I wanna beat you very bad, man. 24 June, you're going to have that time. Bye.
Wanderlei, are you still there? Can I ask you a question?
Yeah.
This story that Chael just told about the brawl on The Ultimate Fighter, did you know that his wife was there? And if so, do you regret going through that with him?
No, come to tell this sad history. Oh, this, that, no, not ever, man. I am a man, he is a man, I have two balls, he have two balls, let's do that. No, I have a reason to start to tell all this sad history.
Right.
Man, let's do it, make the job, make the good fight, make one of the biggest fights of the history, and I want to beat you so bad.
Anything you want to say to Wanderlei, Chael?
No.
Can I ask you the same question, Wanderlei, before you go? And I appreciate you calling in. I asked Chael, why do you dislike Wanderlei? He told me, why do you dislike Chael?
Man, we
lost him.
We are the top fighters in the world. We're going to make one of the biggest fights of the history. You know, one of the most famous arenas in the world. In that day, Bellator is going to be biggest than UFC. We're going to make Bellator biggest than UFC in that day. For the first time, in a lot of times, but that day, we're going to make one of the biggest events in the world. And I wanted to tell just one thing for you, Chael. Let's go, stop to talking, let's go training, because, man, you're going to be in trouble with me in June. Bye.
Thank you, Wanderlei. Bye. Did you get that?
I got that.
At the end?
It took me a second there.
Wow, how about that?
I thought it was a voice. So I was waiting for him to pop up. Okay, what's Ariel pulling? That was Wanderlei.
That was. Well, you thought that whole thing was a rib.
No, well, I actually thought it was, I thought, this guy's really good. I thought it was a rib, but I was waiting for his face to pop up. And when it didn't, I was like, oh, Ariel's pulling one.
Wanderlei's only been on the show once. I'm not a texting buddy with him.
So how do you know it was him? Same way I do, it sounded just like him?
No, in my ear, they told me, hey.
Okay.
Wanderlei just called in.
All right.
How about that?
Pretty cool.
That's something.
I'm very happy for you.
But you didn't want to talk to him.
You know, I don't know what to say. I didn't know what to say that whole time. Are we doing a back and forth? Like, we have a press conference tomorrow, out here in New York. But he's not coming.
He's not coming?
He's not coming to the press conference.
Why?
And then this is another reason I thought that was a rib.
He's on the list.
He's not coming to the press conference. So then I go from here to Chicago, Mo versus Rampage, live, free, and only on Spike TV.
That's true, I heard.
So I'm going out to Chicago for that, and we're going to do a face-off. Everybody that's on the pay-per-view, everybody that will be at the press conference, will be. Wanderlei's not coming. It's like, Van, what do you mean you're not coming? Who misses a press conference in New York City? Who doesn't go live on Spike TV for some kind of a promo? But he's not coming. But here he is on the MMA. You pulled off what MSG,
Finally.
And frankly, what Spike, even Friday with Mo and Rampage.
And by the way, I didn't pull off anything.
9 p.m., 6 in the West.
He listens to the show, clearly, tunes in.
He's on the show. You pulled it up.
How did I time it? How did I time it that we were just talking about him, and then there he is calling into the show?
But you're a genius.
Here's the thing. I'm not taking any credit. Here's the thing.
I feel like you're taking the credit.
No. I mean, look, the show is the show. It's a good platform.
All right.
I mean, could Joel pull something like this off? Let's not get into that. Let's not get into Joel. I mean, you talk about a scrub of all scrubs. I mean, the job squad. Tell that guy to get my name out of his mouth. Listen, honestly.
I will tell him.
Honestly. When you come to New York and find out that this guy is not coming to the press conference, this is shades of the Conor McGregor thing of a couple.
Right.
Like, are you saying, I'm out of here? Why should I come from Oregon? Oregon to New York is not quite Brazil to New York, but I mean, it's not next door.
I thought it was disheartening. I mean, I would have come either way, but I did think it was disheartening, and I thought it was confusing. It's like, hey, Wanderlei, you know, not for nothing, but again, you've got two veterans of the business. Don't just forget the sport, but we both should know the business, but I feel like only one of us does. You know, we are the main event at MSG. Fedor's got to jerk the curtain. In fairness, you know, Fedor's a legend. Fedor's an absolute legend. You have some title fights going down that night, and we're headlining the whole show. There is an obligation that comes with that. You get on the airplane, you come to the press conference, and I thought that it was surprising that he didn't. So it's quite literal when I tell you.
Yeah.
We couldn't pull this off. We couldn't even pull it off for Friday night during the Mo Rampage fight, and you just pull it off on the MMA hour. So you see why I was a little bit cautious. Like, okay. When you said, hey, do you have anything to say to Wanderlei? I said, no, because I was processing in my mind, is this even Wanderlei?
Yeah.
Is this Wanderlei? But I believe that was Wanderlei.
So it's a little deflating because tomorrow you're going to have no dance partner, right? Like, you can't do the face-off, right?
I feel like it's a little bit bizarre, but I also don't know the backstory. I just got here. I got in last night, you know.
Did you threaten to, go
no,
back?
No, I would never leave. But I have vowed that the next time I see Wanderlei, I will be fighting Wanderlei. And I trust that that is true. So they might have just said, look, why even get these guys together?
You know, this was your chance to say something to him. You're not going to get a chance tomorrow. Now I'm even more surprised you didn't say anything.
Yeah, well, you understand why I was a little apprehensive as to whether it was him. You know, you didn't have that backstory. I didn't know you didn't know that.
No.
He's not coming to the press. He's not doing any media. So it's like, well, why would he? How would he know? We're live. Some fans may not know this. We're live right now. So, yeah. He's literally listened to your show and took the time to call in. I don't even know what time it is. I wish I would have had a back and forth with him, but it caught me off guard.
Wow. We got you speechless.
Yeah. I don't know if you have me speechless, but I did think I wasn't sure it was Wanderlei.
You didn't want to play a part in what was, in your opinion, a joke.
In case it was a joke. Yeah. In case it was a joke.
I think
what
I would do
I
that to you.
No, I don't know that you would, but you know, you have to understand, in fairness, when his face didn't pop up,
sure.
You could have been getting Yeah, I'm not representing our audience that you got, but that was Wanderlei. Sure. But I don't know that either one of us knew at the time.
Yeah. Let me ask you, you mentioned something about Golovkin-Jacobs as we kind of move on from that. I'm still kind of a bit jumpy over everything that just occurred. I don't know about you. You seem to be looking at me stone cold face, so I'm going to move on from
it.
You said 170 was a bit of a bust, pay-per-view buys.
Yeah.
What's a success for Belter's second pay-per-view?
Oh, for Bellator. So let's see. Well, I mean, I guess it's like anything. You got to move forward. So you look at what their previous numbers were.
You know what? It was?
Yeah, they did. I don't know if we're supposed to disclose this. They did Mo versus Rampage, and I was just given the information. They did 280. And for
that
me,
much?
That would be, yeah, for me, that would be a success, because for most, I could tell you, for the UFC, the break even about 200 is just kind of the rule of thumb.
Yeah.
So they did 280. We would expect more. I don't know what a good, I think I would like to see a $500,000. But they may have loftier goals. For me, I think that would be good, because it is the second one. Don't forget, you've got an education process. I just came through. I'm going to tie this into something else. Errol, I just came through The Celebrity Apprentice, which bombed. We did terrible ratings. And a lot
that
of
was
people,
Schwarzenegger's fault,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, a lot of people, well, it absolutely wasn't, but they blamed it on Schwarzenegger.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm going, well, time out a second. When Trump did it, and I was a big fan of the show when he did it, so I always watched. I didn't have to bone up on it, because I went on. I watched it legitimately, but it was on Thursday nights. And they had like 7 or 8 seasons, and it was always on Thursday nights. So when Schwarzenegger went in there, they moved it to Monday. And there was like an education process where you have to inform people, this is now on Monday. I was on the show, and on Sunday, I knew it was that week. I thought it was Thursday. And somebody told me, no, it airs tomorrow. And I argued with them. And I said, no, the show's on Thursday. I was on the show, and I didn't know it was on Monday. Only point I'm trying to make there is I do believe this card is outstanding. I believe it's going to do very big numbers. But I think that people do need to understand there is an education process. And if Mo Rampage a number of years ago, and that was headlined by one show, I couldn't even tell you what the co-main was. If they did just south of 300,000, I think that a half a million with his card is fair.
Smashing success.
Yeah, but it might insult some people at Bellator. I'm not trying to insult them as much as be fair that you do have to let people know you've given them live free products for years, largely on Friday nights. You are now moving to pay-per-view and you're moving to Saturday night. And the UFC has seen this in reverse. You'll remember when Brock Lesnar fought Overeem, mega fight, but they moved it to a Friday.
Yep.
On a Friday night, they did 560,000 buys. That was a success for them, but Brock Lesnar on a card against Overeem, particularly at that time, is going to do north of a million, but you move the night.
Yeah, yeah. No, it's tricky because Bellator has always been that free TV, if you want to call it free TV, cable product, and now you're asking people to pay. Do you know how much? I could ask Scott this in a few minutes, but, you know, you're kind of the...
I don't, but I'm comfortable telling you $50. I mean, is that just what a pay-per-view is nowadays?
Is that because they haven't officially said it. It wasn't in the press release. Is it $50?
I don't know, but okay. I know I'm UFC's close like enough 60. That I won't hurt anybody's feelings. Has UFC moved up to 60?
Yeah, with HD.
Because you get it in HD, yeah. And I always order it in HD. I can't tell the difference, and I still get it in HD. Yeah, I know.
That week was particularly weird for you. Did they time it to where your fight with Tito happened at the same time as you getting kicked off The Apprentice? I mean, it happened in the span of like 3 days.
If they did, they'd have had to have major insider knowledge, you know, because we're not allowed to tell. That was my third delve into reality TV, if you will, Ultimate Fighter 1 and the Brazil thing and then this. But all the contracts were very similar, that if you tell anybody how this $5 million.
Wow.
UFC's contract is that way. In Brazil, with Globo, is that way. And with NBC, it was $5 million. So I don't know of anybody of my castmates or anybody that slipped a secret. If Bellator had some way to get that knowledge, I'd be stunned. I think it was just
you regret. And so the story is that you cheated, right? You
yes,
cut
did
the
you
cord.
See it?
I did see it.
Oh, hey, good move by me?
I mean, it was controversial, and it certainly got
good
a
move,
lot
though.
Of
people. Did you like it? Good for TV?
Good for TV, but you got kicked out.
Yeah,
how much money is at stake, by the
way? So here's what you have to understand. On that show, they do what's called Equal Nations, which is a legal term in California, which is everybody's treated the same. If you win the show or you go out on the first day, everybody gets the same.
Of course it was a good move.
Everybody gets the same hotel, the same. Everybody gets Equal Nations clause. Here was the problem with Celebrity Apprentice. Nobody understood what we were doing. And it's like, castmates, let me all get you guys together. And you can't explain this to somebody, Errol. It's like the MMA business. You either get it or you don't. And I can't teach it to you. You get it or you don't. Castmates, this isn't real. There is no job at the end of this. There is no company called Schwarzenegger Inc. Now, the difference when Trump did it, it was real in that if you won that, you really were the apprentice. You would relocate, you would go to work at Trump Tower, and he would assign you to a job site for 12 months which came with a salary. It was real. He was hiring somebody. He would mentor them and inspire them. This isn't real. This Celebrity Apprentice, the only thing we're after is ratings. So let's go out and let's give some people some ratings. And it was so tough with my castmates because they were so worried about how they'd be depicted. And it's like, guys, forget about how you're depicted. We're all hired by NBC. We're all here to do a job, which is to deliver. This is a ratings grab, and that's okay. But that's what it's represented to the viewer as, too. So let's give them what they want. Let's make some TV here. And you just could not get these B-level celebrity wannabes to go along with it, man. They were all so tied to it in their image. And it's like, but guys, this isn't real. There's not really a job. However, you might be around next week.
Right.
So let's go out and let's make some television.
Right, and you did.
We made great TV.
Yeah.
Highest rated of the year, of the season, for sure. I mean, not even close. Knew it was going to be going in. And it's like, hey, guys, you're missing an opportunity here. Let's build some TV. And we had some other storylines. And I don't fault them for it. It's just not how I would have done it. Some other storylines that were buried. I mean, from fights to drinking to drug use to all these storylines that were captured that got buried. And it's like, hey, guys, I'm not sure you want to do that. I mean, it's TV. Let's tell these stories and make some TV.
Did they get mad at you for cutting the cord? No, right?
No, of course not. But I was mad at the way the thing came out.
Sure.
Only in that it's like, hey, guys, I know what the ratings are. This is all going to come out. That's the single greatest thing that's happened here because it's so dull. You know, everybody was so dull because they missed the point. This is a ratings grab, and it's nothing else. So let's go out and create some TV. So No, they weren't actually mad.
Speaking of ratings and things like that.
Would you be mad at your highest rated show?
Of course not.
Right, of course. Of course not.
This has been the best month or so for Bellator in the sense of positive headlines, signing people and things like that. Are you surprised at all this? Like, did you think this would happen so soon with all these fighters coming aboard? I mean, Ryan Bader, Larkin, Dennis, Michael McDonald in the span of like 10 days.
McDonald, how cool is that? McDonald back.
Out of nowhere.
I thought he was just like gone or something. You know, he's a ton of fun. So, now I don't know if I was surprised, but the way the sport has moved forward and UFC included, I would include them in this. I had no idea, 20 years ago, even 10 years ago, that it would be as big as it is or that the opportunities would be here. I do some commentating and, there was never once in my life that I dreamed of being a commentator because that didn't exist. Those opportunities weren't even there. And, you know, the UFC moved forward so fast. Bellator and Spike have moved their company forward so fast. Selling out arenas, as I told you at the beginning of this interview, from the Mohegan Sun to San Jose is really a remarkable thing. I think this Mo Rampage fight, for me, it's a big deal because there's always a spot for Rampage. Always a spot when Rampage is going to go out there. I think that it's at heavyweight, makes it very intriguing. We saw the first one, but now you're changing the weight class. Is that good for Rampage? Is that bad for Rampage? Yeah. Historically, that's bad. Yeah. When a guy comes in that big, it's bad, but he's very cognizant of it, and he thinks it's going to help him. I think you got to take him at his word. So Bellator has made so many interesting moves, and going back to pay-per-view, I can tell you when I signed with them, I had no hints or indications that they were going to go in that direction. I thought that it was going to be just the ratings and gate business. Coker plays things very, very close to the chest. So I don't have like insider knowledge that I don't share with you. He doesn't share it. He keeps his cards tight and he makes his moves, but he's got some visions, man, and he's carrying through with them.
The topic du jour is we're moving away from sport. We're going more towards entertainment. I mean, you got the entertainment side of things better than anyone. I remember for that Yushin Okami fight, you blew my mind with the way you talked about it, the build to the fight and how you were frustrated that he wasn't pulling his weight. So you've been talking about this before anyone. Are you bothered by anything that's going on, in particular more in the UFC? Like, do you feel like the sport is moving away from what it was a couple of years ago?
No, for the best. Yes, I think that's very positive. Okay. And I think when you look at the numbers, you look at the ticket sales, you look at the live gate, I think that people would agree with me. Now, you do have to be cognizant. You know, you're playing some politics here. You want to put on the biggest fights, which Dana's very open in telling people, this is a business, I put on the biggest fights. But to be respected, you also have to balance that with the ratings. You've got to put on the right guys at times. So you try to balance that, and I think that it's pretty tough to do. Now, generally, Ariel, the good news is your best guy is your biggest draw. They usually go hand in hand, but sometimes they don't. Sometimes you get a guy like George St. Pierre, who's not in the rankings at all, but he's been sitting out since November of 2013. So, of course he can't be in the rankings. You're going to tell me George St. Pierre isn't the number one contender? Man, that's horse crap. George St. Pierre is always the number one contender. So you've got to make some room for that. And then what do you do when you got a big star like Conor McGregor, who's proved how great he is? Double champion in the two hardest weight classes the sport even had. He's got both belts, but he wanted to take a little time off. He had the baby that he disclosed to us, and he's got the Floyd Mayweather thing coming. What do you do, man? You do the best that you can. You come with an interim title. You put Khabib and Tony. You miss the fight. You try to do it again. I mean, there's only so many right ways you can do it. But, yes, if they're going to lean towards entertainment and if that drives the – nothing trumps the industry. I see these prick fighters all the time. We've got them at Bellator. The UFC is plagued with these bums. That they think they're bigger than the sport. Nothing is bigger than the industry. Guys like you, guys like me that do other things outside the business, nothing trumps the industry. And if you try to put yourself or your own knowledge or whatever matchups there are, or how long you need for a training camp, if you try to put yourself in front of the industry, you do not have a spot in it.
Conor Floyd, you tweeted about it. You said it's on.
Yeah, that fight's happening.
It's a done deal.
Is really weird. Here's the problem. So we've got the who and the what. We don't have the where and the when, so you can't really do a story until you have a venue, until you have the where and the when. But here's how it worked, and you'll co-sign what I'm going to say. If you hear a fight is going to happen and you're a responsible reporter, you're going to get as close to that source as you possibly can. And generally, it's going to be a trainer. It's going to be a manager. It's going to be a coach. It might be a girlfriend or a wife. If you actually get a hold of Conor McGregor and he tells you, yes, it's happening, you report it. In this case, we've got a hold of Conor. He's told us, yes. We've got a hold of Floyd. He's told us yes. So you either report that the fight's happening or you're calling these guys liars. It's one of the two. Either Conor and Floyd, who have both said they're going to fight each other, right, are liars, or you report that it's happening. Now, yes, I do have the source. As you well know, you never give up your source. Mine's at the ticketing company. He said, go ahead and out me. He said, go ahead and out me. I'd love to be part of the story. Just leave my name out of it. But they were submitted what's called a build. And in promoter talk, that's the first thing that you give to the ticketing company, which is where you get your fire marshals involved, figure out your capacity, show them the layout, where the ring's going to be, where the walkouts are going to be. A build was submitted for that event. That does not make it factual. I have to admit, that does not make it factual. But I believe it.
Wow.
And on
good
top
source
of that, yeah, Ticketmaster, the guy at Ticketmaster, okay, that's not who's going to be doing their tickets, but yeah, his counterpart revealed this to him. But I would tell you this, Conor and Floyd said it's happening. Where in history of fighting have the two main principals said yes and a media guy didn't come out and say it's happening? You either announce that fight or you're calling Conor and Floyd liars, which is okay because they both are at times. So, I mean, but those are your options.
You know when?
No, I don't know when. Okay. I read a report that it was going to be June 10th, but I don't personally believe that. I don't think it'll be June 10th. Conor came out and said that it would be later in September. And don't forget, the only divisible here that was separating this was Dana White for the longest time. Yeah. Now Dana White's come out and said yes, and people still won't report it.
Surprised?
So we've got Dana that's saying, yeah, go ahead. We've got Conor and Floyd saying it's on, and we don't have a media outlet out there, aside from me, that will come out and put their name behind it and say it's on. But I will tell you it's on.
That's my reason for not reporting it.
Sure.
Are you surprised he's saying yes?
Well, and if you're going to do it, Errol, in fairness, you do need a where and when. You do need to have that date signed. So I can understand that. Am I surprised Dana said, yeah, a little bit. I'd like to know the backstory. Is he co-promoting?
You don't text anymore?
Is he going to be the straight? Well, I haven't asked him about it. What am I going to text him and say? Give me some scoop that you
haven't
told
anyone
else.
Get him on your show. You never had him on your show.
Should we call him right now?
No, I don't think so.
Why?
I mean,
are you on bad terms with him?
No, I just don't think he would appreciate that.
Are you scared of Dana?
Not at all.
You sound scared of Dana.
You can call him. Huh? Go ahead. Do it.
I feel like you check it out. It's your show. I was trying to get you a boost there. You don't want to do it?
Go ahead.
Huh?
Do it.
What should we ask him?
Why did he agree to let this fight happen?
I feel like you missed your mark. I feel like maybe you did.
I feel like the real miss mark was when you didn't speak to Wanderlei when he called in on the show.
I think that was a missed opportunity by me. Yeah, I thought that was a missed opportunity by me. You did have me off guard a little bit. You could see, in fairness, though, if you're sitting in my shoes, where you hear this guy's voice that you haven't seen in years, you find out he's not coming to New York for a press conference. He's not going to Chicago for press. And he calls into the MMA era. In fairness, you could see where I would have been skeptical.
Perhaps what we really revealed is how low you think of my show, that of all places he would show up is this little rinky-dink
operation.
You know,
that's not how I meant it, but I think if we were comparing it to, you know, the mega millions they're putting into this, that you think the guy would have got on an airplane. A little bit bizarre.
Yeah. Okay, last thing. WrestleMania this weekend, you watching?
So next weekend, April 2nd.
Well, this coming up.
Oh, geez, it's already here. You're completely correct. I didn't know it was coming that fast. I will absolutely be watching. I love that Shane is back.
Yeah.
I also love that Shane will do the job. He's the only one in that family whose ego will let him put business first. I think the matchup's great. And then, you know, you got the Relic versus Brock, but I don't know what's going to happen
there.
Who's
the Relic?
Goldberg.
Oh, Goldberg.
You know, you got Goldberg versus Brock, and in any normal circumstance, you and I would sit here and go, oh, yeah, Brock's going to go over. And I do agree that Brock's going to go over, but they at least created that I'm not sure in your mind because they had Brock get squash ties. And I'll remind you this. When Goldberg signed on, it was to take him through WrestleMania. So when he squashes Brock, the very first time he did it, it was obvious, okay, he gets his payback. But they're a public company now, so this information's hard to keep quiet. They just signed Goldberg to an extension. So... does Brock go over? Yes. Does Brock beat him clean? Yes. Is there enough speculation based on what I just told you that Goldberg got an extension and they love to swerve the fans at WrestleMania? Is there enough there to make us all tune in and buy? Yeah, I think so, man. They do crazy stuff at WrestleMania. It'll be clean. There won't be interference. One guy will win. It should be Brock. But you can't guarantee it at WrestleMania.
I love how big of a mark you are for.
Do you remember?
Do you read the Wrestling Observer newsletter and get all this information?
No, but he's good. Meltzer's very good. Yeah, he used to be the main dirt sheet that I did read. Now I just follow it, and Twitter's kind of gotten there. But Meltzer has been the man for a long time. I'll tell you this, Ariel.
Yeah.
Do you remember when Seth Rollins? Do you have another guest after me?
Yeah, Scott Coker.
Oh, where the boss is coming in. Yeah. Okay, well, then I'll go fast in case he's in the back. But do you remember when Seth Rollins cashed in Money in the Bank?
Yes.
Okay, but why that was so exciting, not only was that a swerve, which WrestleMania loves to give you a swerve, it was a clean finish, which WrestleMania always gives you a clean finish, but Seth had just lost 45 minutes earlier clean to Orton.
Yeah.
So you would never see that coming. It was brilliant writing. I'm told Pat Patterson came up with that brainchild all on his own, and he deserves credit, even years later.
Well, to me, what drove me away from wrestling was it became too predictable. You could see the outcomes a mile away, and that's why I love MMA so much. I mean, perfect example. This is an old school, I'm surprised you didn't make the connection. This is an old school, like Memphis pro wrestling match we're getting Friday on Spike TV. Rampage is leaving.
Yeah.
His contract's up.
Yeah.
He has to go back to the UFC.
That's right.
He's leaving the territory in wrestling.
Or leave and retire, but yeah, you're right.
In wrestling, he would do the job, no ifs, ands, or buts. Yep. MMA, he could beat one of the biggest stars and then move on.
Yeah.
That's kind of a mess.
Yeah.
That's what I love so much about it.
All right, I'm going to split. I didn't know Coker was. Okay. I'm going to split. But Eric, may I ask you this? Because I'm calling that fight, so I kind of have to stay out of it. Will you give me a prediction on Mo versus Rampage?
I don't do predictions.
You stay out of predictions.
I don't do predictions.
Will you agree with me on this, though? Can we both agree? The weight is the biggest storyline here, because even if you go back to that first fight, which was controversial and leaned towards Rampage, even if you go back to that and use that as a historical tracking point to tell you where this fight's going to go, the weight does change things, because Rampage on that conference call, and I think this is gamesmanship, we're going to find out Thursday, Rampage claims he's coming in at 260. Now, I was just with Rampage about 3 weeks ago. He's not 260, but the point is he's coming in big. So that either helps him or that hurts him, and I think that's the storyline. Am I wrong?
No, that's a great. I mean, we talked about that with Mo on the show, because sometimes with like BJ Penn, when he fights at 170, he just isn't as motivated. So sometimes people use the extra weight as a chance to lay off the gas. Let me say this one last thing before you go. Friend to friend, one thing that I have always admired, maybe the thing I admired most about you, is your ability to move on from things. I was so impressed with how you moved on from the Tito fight. I know that means a lot. In your personal life, you've been through a lot. In your professional life, you've been through a lot. You show us, and this is a big thing for me, dating back to how Ronda dealt with her losses, Conor dealt with his. Dominic, I thought, was phenomenal. It's very impressive when you're talking about, you know, the stars of the sport, how they deal with things, and in particular, adversity publicly. And you do it better than anyone. And people could take shots at you and say that you don't really care. I know how much you care. I know how much that loss meant to you. And it was just really impressive to see how you showed up, you faced the music, and now you're moving on to June 24th. So kudos to you. And I don't know how you do it, to be honest, because just being frank, you have been through a lot.
Sure. That's a tremendous compliment. I appreciate
that.
So
kudos to you.
If I may respond to that, just for your listeners, you know, you have good days and bad days. And what do you do on a good day? You get up, you put your boots on, you go to work. What happens on a bad day? You get up, you put your boots on, and you go to work. My father was a plumber. That's very hard work, particularly in Oregon, where you're outdoor and it's raining and it's snowing and everything else. He never missed work. You get up and you go to work and you move forward to support your family and support yourself and whatever it is. And when I look at our fans that work hard and they pay their hard-earned money to come out to Madison Square Garden and support this event on June 24th, to go out to Chicago and watch Mo and Rampage this Friday, to stay home and order some pizzas and get some beers and get some people. You know, you have to understand, our fans get up and they work hard and they don't get off for excuses. And some days go your way and some days don't. And when I watch these prima donna fighters that have to go to work three times a year and then they want to hang their head after they got famous and they got notoriety and they got a paycheck and they got all of these opportunities, I don't understand it. You know, if you look at our boss, Scott Coker, you think every show's gone his way, Ariel? It doesn't. But he gets up the next day, he puts his boots on, and he goes to work so that everybody can have an industry. And it's so important to do. That was a tremendous compliment you just gave me. And it is very hard. And there are days I'm an actor. I got to put on my game face, man, but I'm hurting inside bad, you know, professionally, or you're ashamed, or, you know, what I went through with my daughter, it's so bad. But you got to become an actor. And what the great actors in Hollywood do is they become people they're not. A guy will become a cowboy, even though he's not really a cowboy. You become that person. And sometimes, man, I'm faking it until I can make it, and I'm putting that face on. But it does hurt. Tito Ortiz sucks, and it hurts so bad to lose to that guy. But what are you going to do? You're going to get up, and you're going to go to practice, and you're going to try to get better, and you're going to try to put yourself in the best opportunity for success in the future. That's all you can do.
Well said. Great
Boom.
Words to end with.
Do you want me to call Dana? Should I call Dana to
do
that
for nice.
I feel like, you know, because you brought in Wanderlei here.
Wanderlei, Dana,
call
you.
Call Dana White.
Let's see what happens here. Scott, what a great introduction for Scott Coker to come in on.
Coker wouldn't be mad in the least. Coker go, hey, Chael, what Dana say? Is that boxing fight's going to hit? Coker will buy tickets and
we'll
go to the fight,
four-way.
Man. Coker's a fan.
He's probably listening right now. Oh, here we go. Oh, there's Scott tuning in. You see him?
We're gonna find out if this fight's happening.
Scott's right there. Oh, he just moved back. Apparently, you and Dana.
Dana must have a new phone, because don't you remember it used to be the Beastie Boys?
Well, we haven't gotten to the voicemail yet.
Is that where that comes? I thought it was a ringtone.
I think he blocked your number. I think he wants nothing to do with you.
I think I go straight to voicemail when your number's blocked, right?
Oh, I don't know. I've never been blocked.
Never been blocked? I feel like I blocked you before.
If anyone, I would have blocked you.
All right, we're not. Oh, how do you like that?
What is that?
That means new number.
Wow.
That means
that's not a number. You didn't get the text? Got the text.
You got a text that he's got a new number? I have two in my phone for him.
I was banned from the arena and still got the text.
Well, then you should be calling him. What am I calling him for? All right, Errol, I've had it with you. Enjoy Coker. What do I do? I get up and leave now?
No, we're going to take a quick break.